But there are no other inspired books of the words of God other than what we have right here in the Bible that we have in front of us. Okay? So, those are my starter words here. There's a lot of, I hate to say lecture-y kind of things here, but I do want to make sure we cover a lot of content to help us, okay? So, the question is, what does canon even mean? Now, this is canon with one end, by the way, not canon with two ends, okay? Canon with two ends is the boom kind of canon, right? The kind that the military used to blow things up. Well, that's not what we have in mind. Canon. What is, you know, you can have a canon of all kinds of literature. You can have a canon of all kinds of things. Well, what we're talking about is the canon of Scripture. Let me tell you what the word canon means. The word canon is derived from the Greek word kanon, which originally meant a straight rod, and then came to mean something like a standard measure. So, when we say canon of Scripture, we're talking about an authoritative norm. So we're talking about something that has been set down, and we say, okay, this is the standard by which we measure our faith in godliness, right? This is the standard by which we measure the truth of God, the words of God, the canon of Scripture. It is an authoritative norm, a standard for us to follow. There's a lot of different views on the Bible, by the way, and how the Bible became our word of God. Okay, there's a lot of different views on that. I'm going to tell you which one we should hold here in just a minute. One view, though, is where people would say that the Bible is merely a bunch of books by human authors which God used to manifest himself. So there's this one view, this one perspective where people go, okay, so people like Paul and Peter and Moses and others were sitting around writing down things, and then we went to read those books and we went, oh wow, well there's some good stuff about God in here. And we should put all this together and say this is God's word. Well, that's kind of a view where it's kind of a liberal view, where you go, okay, so this is a view where These are books. Joe could have written a book. Mr. Robert could have written a book. Brother Don could have written a book. And maybe it's got some good nuggets of wisdom in there, and we can take those things. Well, that's one thing. What about the Catholics? What do Catholics believe? Catholics believe that the Bible has canonical status conferred upon it by the Catholic Church. In other words, what that means is the Catholic Church says the Bible is authoritative because we say so. That's what it boils down to. The Bible is authoritative because we say it is. The Bible is the Word of God because we have not recognized its authority, but conferred its authority upon it. Okay, so that's a key difference in our view and the Catholic view. They say it is the Word of God because we say so. We're going to say it is the Word of God because it says so. That's the difference, okay? And so the Catholic Church says, okay, we believe that these are the words of God, therefore it is, okay? Well, our view, the evangelical view, it's that God himself gave authority to the writings by inspiration of the Holy Spirit. And he providentially guided his people to recognize these writings as coming from him, and therefore ultimately authoritative. In other words, we do not canonize Scripture, we merely recognize it as God's authoritative word. So that's a nuanced difference here, okay? It's not that we say that the Bible, we give any kind of authority to it. The Bible has its authority, and we simply recognize its authority. We recognize, because of God's grace to us, that these are the words of God. We haven't decided that they would be the words of God. We simply said, he spoke, and it's true. We believe it to be so. Okay, we recognize it as his. Now, from that we have to go, okay, so how we have in our Bibles, now we're going to talk a little bit about what the Catholics might have too. We have in our Bibles what we call the Old Testament and the New Testament, right? We have the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Catholics, they have the Apocrypha. The Apocrypha. Anybody got a Catholic Bible? So what? Yeah. Should have the Apocrypha in it if it's a good Catholic Bible. All right, we're going to talk about that now. But, and then we have, of course, the New Testament. So the Old Testament, the New Testament, the Apocrypha. Now, we're going to talk about how the Old Testament came to be, recognized at least. We're going to talk about why we should reject the Apocrypha, the hidden books. And we're going to talk about how the New Testament came to be, because we're going to get one. So starting off, the Old Testament. So, let me say this. This won't be on the screen, this won't be up here. The Old Testament, obviously, was written over a long period of time, right? I mean, that's pretty clear, isn't it? If you read the Old Testament, how many of you, hopefully I won't make you raise your hand. Hopefully a lot of you are reading along with your church through the Bible reading plans here. And so you're working your way through Genesis right now. And so you see a lot of time even in the book of Genesis passing, right? And as you read through the Old Testament, you'll see a whole lot of time passing. And so you go all the way from Genesis to Malachi and you'll see a lot of different things occurring. Well, so obviously it was written over a long period of time, and certain books were probably accepted to be the Word of God at various points throughout the history of Israel, right? Particularly the law. I mean, the law right off the bat, pretty early, was obviously recognized. At times, they had to recognize that they had a word from a prophet, say Samuel, or say Isaiah, or say Jeremiah, or someone. They had to recognize that these were the words of God. So we aren't exactly sure, Angie's giving you the notes here, we aren't exactly sure when it was completed, but it was completed over a period of time. So we aren't exactly sure when the Old Testament canon was completed, but it seems to be a gradual process of completion. It seems that it happened over a long period of time, but was obviously completed by the time of Jesus, because he references the law, the prophets, and the writings. Those are the three distinctions that the Hebrews would make, the Jews would make, over the Old Testament. They would say they have the Tanakh. So the Torah is the law. The Nevi'im is, the prophets. And Ketuvim is the writings. Or that could be the other way around. Someone can Google it correctly. So it's the law, the writings, and the prophets. Okay? And so, they would recognize those three components, and Jesus would have referred to those three particular areas of the Old Testament as we have it, as just the Bible at the time. Well, so we don't know when exactly the Old Testament, as we know it, was kind of completed and compiled, but what we do know is it was recognized by the time of Jesus, and there were certain factors, certain criteria that gauged whether a book was accepted to be a part of the Old Testament canon or not. What were those factors? What were those key characteristics? Well, one was prophetic authorship. Prophetic authorship. So it needed to be written by a prophet or an associate of a prophet, someone like Moses, who was prophesying to the people of God and leading them, right? It had to be written by someone with that type of prophetic authority. It also had to have the testimony of the Holy Spirit. Now, what do we mean by that? The testimony of the Holy Spirit. The writings usually were either accompanied by miraculous power through the Spirit, like with Moses, or the Spirit accomplished what was written in a way that pointed to his role. So, for example, the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments, right? When Moses goes up onto Mount Sinai, he comes down with a couple of tablets. He throws those down and breaks them, but he winds up going back up and getting another set from the Lord that he has written by his own hand. That's a miraculous moment that testifies to the truth of what is spoken in the Ten Commandments, right? Or you can just see how when Isaiah prophesies and those things come to be, right? There's an action on the back end of those prophecies that cause them to be reality. Well, a testimony of the Holy Spirit. So a book had to be written by a prophet or an associate of a prophet, had to have the testimony of the Holy Spirit. Providential care. God preserved these words in a nation that was often disobedient and destroyed. His protection of his writings was considered a factor in their recognition. So, you take Israel. Okay, Israel wound up in Babylonian captivity. They wound up, ran out of town multiple times, right? And Israel suffered a lot. And yet, over all that time, God continued to providentially care for and preserve his words, right? Think about Josiah. He brings a revival to the land by what? Having the law read when it was simply found. They discovered the law, right? God had preserved the words that he intended for his people to hear. He did that over a long period of time to keep it together. Well, so prophetic authorship, the testimony of the Holy Spirit, providential care, and this last one is a Christian component. Validation by Christ. Validation by Christ. Why do we include the books that we have in the Old Testament as the Old Testament? Not simply because the Jews say that it's the Bible, but because Jesus testified to its validity. Because Jesus referenced the law, the writings, and the prophets. And so that's why we accept the Old Testament. How many books are in the Old Testament? Anybody know? The 66 in the whole Bible. Whole Bible. How many in the Old Testament? 39, how many in the New Testament? Math quizzes. 27, all right? Yeah, so 39 books in the Old Testament. Well, we say 39. The Jews say 24, I believe. 24. They bunch of them up. So Ezra and Nehemiah go together. The minor prophets are all one book. There's some other combinations. Anyway, so they have 24. The first and second Chronicles, first and second Kings, first and second Samuel, all those are just one book. Well, anyway. We have our 39 books because of these four criteria. Well, we have another question. You may or may not care about this. I find it interesting. That's why we're going to talk about it. The Apocrypha. Why do the Catholics have more books in their Bible than we do? Because they're extra spiritual? Because they want to be more better readers than we are? No. They have some books that have been accepted by the Catholic Church and the Eastern Orthodox Church, but Protestants and Jews, for that matter, reject these writings to be a part of the Word of God. Well, the Apocrypha, what does Apocrypha mean? It means something like hidden books. Why do we reject them? That's the big question. Why do we reject the books that they accept? Well, one reason, is that no Jewish list of Old Testament books contain the apocryphal books at all. So if the Jews, and these books were written around the same time as in either the intertestamental period, a lot of them in the intertestamental period, which was between the Old Testament and the New Testament, or around the same time as some of the Old Testament books. Well, these books were written, and the Jews knew about them, but did not include them in the Bible. So if the Jews saw that these books are available, but didn't include them in the words of God, then they may have been on to something. Okay? They may have been on to something. So no Jewish list contained them. Here's another thing. Jesus, nor the New Testament writers, none of them, cited these books, though they clearly would have been aware of them. They didn't cite them. They cited the law, the writings, the prophets. They never cited these apocryphal books. Ever. Another thing, in the first four centuries of the church, so the 100s, 200s, 300s, and 400s, that's a long time ago. Anybody remember back then? No. All right, so way back then, for the first four centuries, in all the books, all the list of the canonical books, these books were excluded. They weren't included in the gathering of the Bible. Another thing, the content of these books oftentimes contradicts the rest of Scripture. For example, here's an example. In some of the apocryphal books, almsgiving makes atonement for sin. So you can pay your way out of the punishment of God, according to the apocryphal books. Now, we know this to be the case because it was lived out by the Catholic Church, right? This was part of the driving force of the Reformation in the 1600s, wasn't it? You may or may not know this story. But there's a guy named Tetzel. He was out raising money to build St. Peter's Basilica. He was out raising money. And he had this little jingle. Something along the lines of, as a coin in the coffer rings, a soul from purgatory springs. So you give your money, somebody gets out of jail free. Gets out of eternal punishment free. Well, that's a teaching from the apocrypha. That's not from the Bible. You read the Bible, cover to cover. You won't find that. But you will if you read the apocrypha. Well, prayers and offerings for the dead in purgatory, that's a concept found in the apocrypha. Those things contradict what we know to be true in Scripture. And the last thing, they make no claim to inspiration themselves. In fact, sometimes they refer to the absence of prophets in Israel in those books. So, if you got a good Catholic friend, keep your good Catholic friend, but tell them to rely on the 66 books in this Protestant Bible and kick those apocryphal books to the curb a little bit for them. They make no claims of inspiration. Well, that brings us to, that might be tiny wording up there. I apologize. How many of you can see that? Maybe. I don't know. Anyway, that brings us to the New Testament. So now, how is the New Testament written? Well, all right. So, you know how it all went down early on, right? So Jesus, well, first off, John the Baptist comes onto the scene, begins to speak about the coming kingdom, right? You know, we could go back and angels sing, Mary, Joseph, all this business. But anyway, John the Baptist comes onto the scene, well, preaching about the coming of Jesus. Jesus shows up, he says, hey, John, baptize me. John goes, no way. But he does anyway. Then Jesus begins his ministry. And much of Jesus' teachings would have been spread orally at that point in time. They weren't immediately written down into books. Right? Why? Why? Because a lot of people couldn't write. Most people couldn't read. And so the easiest way and the best way for a large portion of the world for a long, long time to get the word out was just that, to get the word out. Start telling people what's been said. So oral tradition would spread the words of Jesus for a long time. But eventually, as the eyewitnesses began to die out, they began to go, you know, my memory might fade on me one of these days. We might ought to jot some of this stuff down. And so through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, what we believe happened was Mark wrote his book, and then Matthew and Luke took Mark's book and some other information that they had from eyewitness testimonies and wrote their books. And then John had to be a little maverick and went his own way. He got his own side of the story. He didn't borrow from Mark. He took some other testimony that was coming along and obviously the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. And he wrote his book. And so then we have the words of Jesus written down in the Gospels. And then Luke, he wrote a second volume. He said, hey, I wrote about Jesus. Now I'm going to write about the spreading of the church. And so he wrote the book of Acts, right? So that's what happened. Luke wrote the book of Acts, which was a history of the growth of the church, breaking every barrier of the known world from Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth, right? So at the end of the book of Acts, Luke writes, and the gospel is going forth unhindered. And so he's writing this history of the church, pressing forward. And then we get into, of course, during all this writing, all this time period that Luke writes in the book of Acts, Paul was writing letters, Peter was writing letters, the author of Hebrews was writing, or was probably preaching a sermon that was written into a letter. All these things are going on. James is writing. John is writing. A lot of people are writing these books, these letters, and all this is going on. And when do we get a New Testament? When does that happen? That's the question. So all this is going on, and obviously the inspiration of the Holy Spirit is leading in all of this. But when do we get the Bible? When do we get the New Testament? When does that finish up? Well, some of it was obviously being recognized at the time that the other writings were taking place. But then a guy with a funny name, Eusebius, a guy named Eusebius in the 200s, I think we're on the next one, there you go, a guy named Eusebius in the 200s, he writes that there was discussion taking place at that time about books that were recognized, books that were disputed, and books that were heretical. So there were writings, and they were trying to figure out what's what here. Some books are really obvious. So Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, those are pretty clear, right? We take those. Those are pretty clear. And some books are a little less clear. These disputed books. Hebrews. Who wrote Hebrews? Don't say Paul. If you say Paul, you are wrong. We don't know. It might have been Paul. Probably was. Might have been Peter. Probably was. We don't know who wrote the book of Hebrews. Jennifer's doing a study on Hebrews. You can tell us all about it. Tell us something. Who wrote Hebrews? Nobody knows. All right. James. Why would James be a disputed book? Emphasis on works, because it appears to contradict the writings of Paul, right? James chapter 2, deals with faith and works. And how does that work with Paul's writings on by grace through faith that you're saved? How does that work? So that's all being disputed at this point in time. 2 John, 3 John, Jude. These books are so small. Who are they written to? What are they about? How do we confirm they're written by these particular authors? Revelation. You can completely understand why Revelation was slow to be accepted. Because, man, this is strange stuff. This language is not like anything else. I have to say this now. A few weeks back, I misspoke. I said that Revelation was apocryphal literature. What I intended to say was it is apocalyptic literature. There's a huge difference there. My deepest apologies. Anyway, so that's what's going on with these books. So these books were disputed. Are they real words from God, or are they just the writings of someone else? Well, all that's taking place in the 200s. Not until 367 AD do we have the first definitive final list of the 27 books that we consider to be the New Testament. It took over 300 years for them to finally pile all this up. Now, you can understand why it took a while, right? We're talking about the 100s, 200s, and 300s here, okay? There is no printing press. There's no printing press. When did the printing press come into existence? Was it 1400s, 1500s? I mean, it was late. Late compared to here. So these guys, how do you get copies of something in the 100s? You sit down and you write it. Right? So you make copies. Have you ever done that? That's terrible. It's just horrible. To sit down and just have to write it out, right? Copy something. Well, that's what they were doing. I've been reading Colossians over and over. I've been trying something new this year. I'm reading our Bible reading as a church, but I read something by this guy who said that he does what's called saturation reading. And so he'll just take one book and just read it every day over and over and over and over and over for a month or 2 months or whatever. And so I've been doing that with Colossians. And at the end of Colossians, he says, oh, and by the way, trade this book with the other church that got another letter. Trade this letter. You read this letter and then pass it on to this other church, and then they'll pass their letter back to you. So all this is going on in the church. And why was it so long? Because they had to make all these copies on their own. And also they were busy doing something. What were they busy doing for the first few hundred years? Preaching the gospel. Planting churches. Spreading the kingdom of God to the ends of the age. They didn't have a whole lot of time for academic debates about do we take Jude or not. They just take the word of God. And they preach about Jesus. And all that was taking place for the first 200 years. And then this guy, Athanasius, he comes onto the scene and he says, hey, here's the books that have been accepted. Now, it had to happen before then. But that's the first guy that wrote that list. And then there were two, we got to give the Catholics their due here. There were two Catholic councils, church councils, in 397 and 419. I didn't even bother writing down which councils they were. You look them up. And they voted. They generally concluded that the Bible was complete and that the canon was what we call closed. And so what, this is not in the notes, and this won't be on the screen. So when we say closed canon, what we mean is there is no new word from God that isn't confirmed and even originating in the Bible. Okay, so what we mean, you might get some word that illuminates something that's already biblical and in Scripture, or you might have something that certainly doesn't contradict, but you can't say, the Lord told me, unless the Lord told you from the Bible, right? You can say, I think this is what God has me doing. I believe this is the direction the Lord is leading me based on His word and my intuition. But we don't get a new word from God. We ground ourselves in the Bible. So, how do we get the Bible? How do we get the New Testament? What was the criteria for accepting the New Testament books? One, much like the Old Testament, apostolicity. So it had to be written by an apostle or a close associate of an apostle. A book would need to be written by an apostle or a close associate of an apostle. Second, reception by the churches. Widespread use in the churches. This is why you won't be adding any new books to the canon. Right? Because even if you theoretically could pull a book from that was found from some cave over in the Middle East, you theoretically could pull it out and somehow assume that it's written by Paul. It'll never be widely accepted among all the churches. But that was taking place with these books, reception by the churches. Christology is the third point. The books had to be Christ-centered. That's what made books like James controversial as well, because there's not any talk about Jesus in the book of James. Orthodoxy is another characteristic. The books had to contain orthodox, right, correct teachings according to apostles. In other words, it couldn't contradict what was written in the other books. And lastly, inspiration. It needed to give evidence of inherent divine inspiration. So, we needed the Bible to, we needed, like 2 Timothy to say, all Scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, correcting, rebuking, training in righteousness, or the other way. So, all that technical stuff to say, okay, so what's the point? Why is this important? What's the point? Well, I'm glad you asked. Over a long, long, long period of time, God took great efforts to preserve His Word so that we might have a reliable manifestation of Himself. You can trust your Bible, so please, please, please do. There's a whole lot of academic stuff that's happened over the last several thousand years. And you might go, well, that's just so boring. And in some ways it might be. But at the end of the day, it was God's grace to you to preserve His words that we might have an accurate and full picture of who He is. That's why all of these little details are important. That's why it's important that we know how we got the Bible. Because if we don't know how we got the Bible that we have, it's very easy to just go down to so-and-so's bookstore and say, oh, here's a lost book of the Bible. Well, this must be accurate. Or your good Mormon friends could come over and knock on your door this Saturday and could offer you a newer testament. The last testament of Jesus Christ, right? They could come by and offer you a new word. Unless you know, there is no new word. We have all we need right here in these 66 books that we hold in front of us. So, I say all that to say, this is an accurate, reliable word from God to show us who He is. Please read it. Please use it. Take time to get to know God. Well, before Jennifer comes to play for us, I do want to give you, this is always dangerous, because man, I don't know if I can even answer half of the possible questions you could have. But was anything unclear, or anything you might have a question about that you'd like to ask really briefly before we finish up? I thought someone might have something. Ms. Brinkley, what you got?
That word you said that you apologize about.
I said.
Yeah, I had no idea what either one of those words.
Okay, apocryphal means something like, okay, so she asked, what's the difference between apocryphal and apocalyptic? Apocryphal and apocalyptic, okay? So, apocryphal is hidden. So these are hidden books that weren't originally a part of the canon that the Catholic Church discovered in their hiddenness basically declared to be words of God. So that's apocryphal. Apocalyptic is something like futuristic, prophetic weirdness. I'm not exactly sure a definition off the top of my head, but that's the type of literature that Revelation is considered. And it is a different type of literature from virtually anything else in the Bible. It's very different there. So that, I don't know if that helps any.
The first one's hidden and the second one's weird.
Second one's weird. That's a good way to describe it. Thank you. Good summary. Anything else? Now that I've insufficiently answered her question, no one else wants to. All right, listen, here's what we're going to do. We're not going to have an invitation so much because we haven't really dealt with the gospel. We haven't really dealt with the foundations of faith tonight. We wanted to deal with some academic things that might help us in our understanding of the Bible. But I do want Jennifer to come and play for us. And what I want you to do during that time, I mean, if you need to come and be prayed with or want to trust Jesus, amen, come on. But what I want you to do is take some time to thank the Lord for the word that he has given us and ask him to help you read it and understand it and obey it. Okay, that's what we're going to do. So let's pray, and then we'll have this time of response. God, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you that you took great pains over a long, long period of time to preserve your word for us. Thank you for a full picture of who you are and what you intend for us. Father, help us to read it, obey it, and walk every day in faith in Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. If you would stand, please, and just thank the Lord.